Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome today on this rainy day. I know that there's lights out and we're trying to figure out everything with Reverend Dave here about technology and lighting and so forth. And so today we will be talking about light. So that's good. So we each have to make our own light today. So we just welcome all of you and are so grateful that you came out on this rainy day. And we're going to be grateful for everything, even for the rain, for the darkness. Praise the darkness even. And so I wanted to share with you the title of the talk. I know that Dave was having trouble getting memos to us and everything. And I didn't get until like Saturday, hey, what's your talk about? But I'll share with you, the talk is about God Only Knows. And this came through a joke. It's been about 3 weeks ago, probably, two at the most. My care partner, Peggy, and I were talking, and I said, I'm going to be speaking like today. And she says, oh, what's the title of your talk? And I go, God Only Knows. I sure didn't know. And I know that Joshua called me the other day and was wondering, and I go, God Only Knows, I sure don't know. However, I knew I was going to piggyback on what these fine young men talked about, Joshua and Dan. So I knew I was going to do that, but I didn't know how I was doing it. And as a good UU student, I was trying to look at everything and see exactly what they had to say at a deeper level. And I hope that I'm able to bring this forward a little bit, at least from my perspective. From my perspective of what they talked about being grateful, they talked about being a witness, they talked about emotional intelligence, and I think with the Candles of Joy and their concern, it was about being authentic. And so I was going to piggyback on that, like I said, and I thought, I'm going to talk about and just try to put that together with those four points. And I came up with bliss, mind, body, spirit, and life, renewal, heart, and healing. So I hope to put all that together in the service today. God only knows how it will turn out. So right now then, I think we're trying to figure out the lighting of the show. That's not difficult. Well, yes. I take that back. Sometimes it is difficult to bring forth the light. And that's what it's really all about. I know that Joshua did his service and he had on his super dad shirt, so I've got on my super shirt today. You know, his intention in life, or at least one of his intentions, is to be a wonderful parent. And he did such a great job on explaining that at the service. And so I saw this Walmart special, and I go, gotta have that, because even in my house, I've got grateful, thankful, blessed. I am so blessed. I am so thankful for all that I have. I am so blessed. And so to bring forth the light today, Joshua, would you mind the lighting of chalice? And we just know that this wonderful divine person is bringing forth the light into our church. And we pray that this light will envelop each one of us. It will be a presence, even with all the darkness that is around. We know that God works wonders. Oh my gosh, we know that. So we bring in the light. We bring in the light, even though there appears to be darkness. One thing that I was reading this week, like when you stand in the dark and you turn on the light, there's the light. But when you turn it out, where does the darkness go? It is a no thing. It's nothing. Because you can flip that on the light. And that's what each one of us have to do, is to flip on the light. And so when we do flip on the light and we're grateful, we know that we are in the light. So let us take a moment of silence to just Well, to begin today, we're also, I said to Joshua, oh my goodness, you guys were really brave. You could put the order of service, you know, with the candles of joy and concern last. And I thought, I'm going to be brave. There's a song, what would I do today if I were brave? I'm going to be brave, and I'm putting it all out of the population. So we're going to be doing a couple of things that I've always wanted to do, was to talk and then to provide a song to go with it. Because for me personally, I always get led deeper by a song. And so first of all, we're going to be talking about gratitude and bliss, which we've talked about already, the light. And also, I just want to say that you know that I am a big proponent of the chakras. And I had somebody come to me this week and said, would you be willing to do services on each one of the chakras? And I said, oh, you mean like a workshop. And so perhaps we can do that. Today I'm not doing in-depth on that, but I wanted you to know as we talk that we're going to talk about that. And that top one is bliss and light. And so we have to have, first of all, if we're on a spiritual path, is that light coming into us and coming and infiltrating us. The next thing that Joshua said is about gratitude. We have to have gratitude. So I want to read from page 65 on A Guide to Spiritual Living. And on that page it says, just a second, God only knows where we're at. There's 65. It's called Be Transformed. The beginning of our new life is like the coming of spring. The air is fresh and the seeds begin to sprout and grow. In fact, spring is the outpicturing of the law. It says in Galatians that for whatever a man or a woman, I will say, sows, therefore they will reap. So, ancient wisdom declares, be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Be transformed. And that's from Romans. But also it says in Proverbs, for as he or she thinketh in his or her heart, so he is. And then he goes on to say that this is a principle, that thoughts held in mind produce after their kind. And if we're talking about mind, we're talking about that purple just below the bliss there. And we're talking about the next one down. Bliss is up here in our higher power. And I know Nancy and I were talking about our higher power. And this part is about faith. And this is your God code, remember? You've got the pineal gland there, and that's about your God code. And then you go down here to your throat chakra, and it also encompasses also walking forward in your life and movement. Sometimes, though, that power just stops you if you are not in the light. And so, thoughts held in mind produce after their kind. And we have to realize that thoughts are things. Thoughts really flow from our thinking, and it becomes our life experience, whatever we're thinking. If we're thinking unconstructive thoughts, like sickness and death and trauma and pain, well, guess what? And we keep playing that over and over and over in our mind. That's exactly what's going to be manifested in our life. But if we begin thinking constructive thoughts, grateful, gratitude, blessed, then that is what's going to come forth. It's called the law of mind action. The law of mind action is about thoughts produced after their kind. And so, what it is, it's called the law that is of mental silence. Well, it's dental science is what it comes up with. The premise is that thoughts are like seeds that we talked about. They bear fruit. The principles each person must discover and work with is the idea that there is a direct relationship between the thoughts that we hold in mind and what happens to us. This concept is in concert with the idea that we are responsible for everything that's happening in our lives, however that manifests out. So, what do we do about this love that's held in mind and take responsibility? Well, we have to do this. We must have an attitude. And I'm not talking about an ego attitude that Joshua was talking about. We have to have an attitude of gratitude. And I thought, there's no better way than a song to explain it by Richard McGee.
I will be universe for me.
Now that we know about attitude of gratitude just a little bit better. Well, the next thing that I remember Joshua talking about was about being the witness and also about emotional intelligence. And I thought, ooh, you know, at first when I heard about witnessing, I thought, ooh, I remember witnessing from people and people trying to save me, you know, and witnessing to me that way. So I had for a moment an attitude like, ooh, I don't want to listen to this. But I looked within my own book about witnessing. And this is from Judith Horloff, Dr. Judith Horloff, and thriving as an empath. So it tells you ways that you can become more centered and have that attitude of gratitude. It's called the witness state. Finding neutrality helps you stay centered during conflict. It can rewire the circuitry in your brain so you approach life with calmly. Instead of being stuck in difficult emotions or situation, gain some distance by taking a few steps back and witnessing with your mind yourself. In other words, bring in that light and that will be there in your neurotransmitters that they talk about. Now scientifically, I know that they've hooked up monks and mystics and looked at their brain functioning when they are in that state of grace that Joshua talked about, in that state of grace when they are meditating, when they're praying. Well, just take for instance, perhaps your mother criticized you and your parents criticized you and were not the best parents, and your partner may disappoint you at times, but just visualize yourself observing the situation rather than being consumed by the emotions you experience. So we're talking about emotional intelligence here. From a wider perspective, you are better able to detach from fear. It's always about fear, anxiety, anger, or any specific issue that arises. Then, when you notice yourself becoming stressed or overwhelmed, tell yourself, I am not this emotion. I can lovingly witness my feelings and state of overwhelmment just as an observer. Oh, that's hard to do, isn't it? It can be very hard to do. I can lovingly witness my feelings and state of overwhelm as the observer. Realizing that no emotion defines you gives you the freedom to shift your mind and set your mindset and connect you with your inner wisdom. When we're talking about wisdom too, if you look there at the big yellow one, that's your wisdom right here in your stomach area, in your solar plexus. This is about you and being authentic. All about you. It's where your ego is also. You have to work on this. These lower chakras you have to work on, especially if you suffer trauma. Well, you set your intention then. I have a choice about how I deal with emotions. When I am frustrated or upset, I will witness my feelings so that I don't simply react when my buttons are pushed. You ever have your buttons pushed? Been there, done that so many times. It reminds me then of our four agreements. Well, really five now that we've got. But it reminds me of that agreement that says, don't take things personally. Don't take things personally. And step back and just try to collect your thoughts. Don't react. And if you find yourself that you're going to react, just take a minute. Maybe just move away for a moment so that you're not just blowing out steam then. Richard sung about it. The first step to move beyond this is what? It is to stand still. Stand still. Don't do anything. Don't. What? What? Just stand still? Oh my goodness. Don't do anything. Just bring in that light. Just take a look at your witnessing. The first step is always moving beyond the challenge is to stand still. Because even Einstein said, we cannot face the problem on the level of the problem. We have to take that problem, that challenge, higher. You know, I've gone through some challenges recently and problems, like problems, and I've tried very much to, you know, be that witness that, falling down, blurting out, whatever. It's called being between a rock and a hard place. And that's exactly how I felt, between a rock and a hard place. It's like Moses, you know, crossing the Red Sea. You all remember the story of Moses, right? There was the Red Sea. And there it was. They either would have to jump in the water and drown, or over here are the Egyptians coming to kill them. Moses was caught in a rock and a hard place. But if you read in Exodus, it says this part, stand still and see the glory of Jehovah. And of course, we know the story that the sea parted and then the Egyptians came into the sea and then swallowed them up. Well, I thought about this. This is a God thing. I didn't even think until this morning. I was in meditation and I go, what is that about Moses? This is all about Moses. We're Moses. I'm Moses in this moment between a rock and a hard place. And so I looked in the Metaphysical Bible Dictionary. We were talking Sunday about Joshua, that people read the Bible and they just take it literally and they don't look at it metaphysically. So I look metaphysically and esoterically. I go, what's Moses mean? What does Moses mean? Moses means drawing out, drawing forth, extracting from water. The birth of Moses represents man's development in consciousness of the law of his being from the negative side. Rock and hard place. Negativity. Not giving blessings for it. Ooh. And we have to look at all challenges as an opportunity to grow. That's the blessing. Water represents universal negation. And I meditated on that, and that has to do with ego and emotions. Water does especially have to do with emotions. Water also represents great possibilities. Remember, we baptize with water, don't we? Out of seeming negative condition comes new growth. When we are in what seems Egyptian darkness, and maybe we're thinking, oh, this is Egyptian darkness right now, where's the light? We are right to go higher in consciousness. Have you ever looked at problems like that, being between a rock and a hard place? That it's really bringing forth the light if you stand still and see the glory of God. Stand still and do nothing. Well, it all boils down to we need to become detached, apparently. Become detached from it. Now, that doesn't mean not be compassionate toward it, but just be detached from it emotionally. And on page 97 of Spiritual Living, it says, it is written that the first mistake made by humankind was to eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. However, a literal tree of knowledge of good and evil does not exist. It doesn't exist. So it's saying to us then about good and evil is that we are not to label. Do not label anything as good or bad. It simply is. We say, it is, and I am. One time I think I was caught up in my ego. I might have shared this before with you. It was when I was teaching, and I desperately wanted from my ego, probably, a higher job, a position. It was like to be a special ed coordinator and go around to all the different schools and coordinate the special ed department. Or at the most, I wanted to you know, like a director telling the director that would come around all about what was happening in our school. And guess what? No amount of prayer or anything made that happen. And so, of course, emotionally, my feelings were hurt. Oh my goodness, oh my goodness. But I wrote on my chalkboard that day, it is and I am. What it really means, it is not good or bad. It is. It's just happening. Whatever is happening in your life, it is happening. It's an opportunity for growth. And I am. And the affirmation is, I am centered and poised in the all-knowing mind of Christ. Nothing, nothing, nothing can disturb the calm peace of my soul. And we could add, I am so blessed. I am so grateful. I am so happy. I am happy for all that I have. I'm so grateful. So, at least we've covered two topics here, and now it will be time for our love to show forth that we'll be talking about next. But the love will be loving our community, and that's what I heard last week, how much people love this community and how much they get out of it and how much they love each other, which we do. We love each one, each and every one, and we accept you. We accept you as you are, no matter what. The next part is about healing and body. Healing those lower chakras. And I should mention that the middle chakra, the green one, is about love. And in my meditation, I just put that one because without love, there's nothing. There's just nothing without the love. But those lower three chakras, and you got to have wisdom, but especially those lower three chakras, according to Wendy DeRosa, is where a lot of energy is held that needs healed. All those traumas that have happened in our lives. And that bottom one, the red one, I was thinking about the Red Sea. And that's about protection. It's about protection and safety. It's also about life. Life. Because in that bottom section, if you think about that, this is where our sexual organs are. And it's also about life. Life. Bringing forth life. Beautiful, beautiful life. And living a beautiful life. Also, this middle one, this one here in orange, is one where many people get stuck. That's where a lot of our trauma is. And we have to cleanse that out through healing. But see, there is a great promise. It comes from Matthew 7:7. It says, ask, and it will be given unto you. Seek and you will find, and knock, the door will be open. See, first of all, you've got to know what to ask for, though. You have to ask for that peace, the peace of God that passes all understanding. You know, we're not here to say, oh, God, give me a Mercedes Benz. You remember that song? Oh, Lord, won't you buy me a Mercedes Benz? Yeah, that's not what we're on earth to do. And when I first heard these words, I just fell off of my seat. I had never heard them spoken in this way from Luke 12:32. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. First of all, we have to figure out what the kingdom is. Where is the kingdom? Remember, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. The kingdom is within you. Yay, I see a nod. Yes, Jeremy, the kingdom is within. The kingdom is within. We talked about that little book that Joshua brought to the board meeting, and it's about the Lord's Prayer and the chakras. And it starts out with our Father, and I added our Father and Mother because I thoroughly, personally believe in that. Our Father, which art in heaven, right here in our Holy be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth, grounded in earth, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. We're talking about digestion right here. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our trespasses. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever and ever. Amen. So we know that evil, whatever we call evil, is not good or bad, but deliver us from evil, evil thoughts, evil thinking. So it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. And you invite the kingdom, that kingdom come, by being still. Invite the kingdom by being still. By being present in the now moment. We're here right now. We're not there. You know, I thought about that. I thought about, when I was doing this service, I go, we made a decision not to go to the Parliament of the World's Religion in Chicago. And, my goodness, that starts today. And I go, I always go to the Parliament. And I go, but we made a decision. We made a decision not to go. And you know what? It's okay. There's all kinds of people, all kinds of religions. There's 80 different religions, I understand. And then I looked at the program and I go, I'm going to miss seeing Michael Beckwith. Oh my goodness, I'm going to miss this person, Charlene Manuelito, that I know. Oh my goodness. And I'm going to miss being with the Sikhs and learning from them. And I'm going to miss this Jewish person that's talking about the tikkun or your purpose on earth. But I go, you know what? We've got the Parliament of the World's Religion right here, don't we? We're all different. We're all different in our belief system, and we all accept and love one another for whatever it is. And you can get up here, and you can say things, and then it's up to the people to check them out if they're interested or not, you know? So, wow. The next thing that you have to do, though, is, as Jesus said to his disciples, you've got to shake the dust from your feet. Remember that one? He gave an order to his disciples to go out and give a message. And if the people accepted it, then, bless them. And if they said, no, that just sounds, I'm going to be skeptical, like our fifth agreement, that's okay, too. Just wipe the dust from your feet and go on. So we have to take that internal look of wiping the dust from our feet to see if we're holding on to any resentment. See, it boils down to forgiveness, and that's what love, that middle chakra, is all about. And it's for us, not for the other person. And I think that there's also a scripture that, it's so hard to forgive, but it is 7 times 77. You have to keep doing it over and over. And I don't think Jesus would have said that unless he knew how hard it would be to forgive. And you can forgive and forgive and forgive. But also, there was another passage in there. It says, love your neighbor as yourself. So it's important, of course, to love your neighbor, but we're missing the part about yourself. Love yourself. Because if you don't love yourself, how can you love your neighbor? So, what we have to do is heal in the hands of time. And Karen Drucker is going to show us that, and after that, we will light the candles of joy and concern. The only hope.
Thank you.
neighbors as yourself and love the world, because it all depends on love.
We want to thank everybody for tuning in today. If you'd like to show your support, please hit the like button. Subscribe to our channel if you're not already subscribed, and help us out by sharing this message by clicking the share button. If you'd like to make a monetary donation to UU Church Houlton, there is a link to our online donations in the video description down below. And again, thank you so much and have a blessed day.